lemon.
She changed the topic name
Yeah,
also. That's Lavanya creativity. Ah, there she is. Too much lover, Lavanya.
Life.
Yes, Sadie, your life.
Okay, let me start again with something which I keep on drilling into people, but not everybody understands. The word love, which is used so freely in the English language. In fact, I remind people that most of us do not even know how to express love in our mother tongue. The equivalent of a simple phrase like I love you. Tell me, how would you say it in Kannada, Tamil, Malayalam, Telugu, or whatever is your mother tongue? We find it so difficult. We go round and about and make some. But in English, it comes out so simply. I love you. You can say that to your parent, you can say that to your best friend, you can say that to your lover or spouse, you can say that to your child. Everywhere it works. But that's one of the reasons why. You know, there is a little bit of misunderstanding of this. In the English language, love is both a verb and a noun. The noun, love, is an emotion. And emotions, as you know very well, come from within. We don't have a control. I don't decide to be angry. I don't decide to be happy. I don't decide to be sad. It comes from within. Something happens and I feel very happy. Something happens and I feel very irritated. Like that, it happens. So it comes from within, we have no control over that. It's an emotion like any other emotion, which is very momentary. You can feel love for 1 second, and the next second you may hate that person or be indifferent to that person or whatever it is. Now, what I'm interested in is love the verb. Love in action. That is where the relationship part comes in. A loving relationship. So when I love this person, see, I can love God. I can love a film star. I can love anybody. I don't have a relationship with that person. That film star may not even know that I exist. But I continue to hero worship and I continue to so-called love that person and things of that sort. What we are interested in is the loving relationship. When we say that I love so and so, I want to have a good relationship with this person, I want to be close to this person, I want to enjoy the company of this person, I want to do something for this person. That is where this whole issue comes up, and that is the difficult part of it, because that's entirely in our control. We can choose with whom and how and where we can have this loving relationship. Now, the extent to which we have loving relationships, a lot of it is based on our early experiences of life. People who grow up in a loving, caring environment find it very easy to love others. People who grow up in a nasty environment and they do not receive love when they are, you know, in their growing years and their personality is being formed, they find it very difficult to form a loving relationship. And on top of that, it is not just you know having a loving relationship with somebody, it is also how you love the person. Because in a relationship, it is not just the emotion is not enough, it is the verb, as I said, the action part of it. So how do you know love the person? For example, you bring home a very exotic plant and you keep it in your house and you know that it's something very unique and you're showing off to everybody. And you love that plant so much that every half an hour you come and pour water over it. Because plants need water. Now what will happen to that plant? You will say, I like or love that plant so much. I was so interested in that plant. I wanted that plant to blossom and bloom and this and that. And that's the reason why I said the plant needs water. So however busy I am, I keep pouring water on that plant. But the plant doesn't survive. Exactly. That's what happens in relationships. Here again, one more thing which I keep reminding people, and I want you again to give a serious thought to it, the opposite of love is not hate. That is another mistake that we make. You can love and hate a person at the same time. And when you hate a person, there is an indicator that you still have emotions towards that person, and that hate can turn back into love. Love can turn into hate. Here is this young man who falls in love with a girl. Okay. Initially he meets her, she meets him, and they just strike up a casual friendship or whatever it is. She's not very serious about it, but okay, fine, she says, like I have so many friends, he's also a friend of mine. But this man decides that he's in love with her. So he proposes to her that I want to have a relationship with you, I want to marry you, whatever it is. This girl said, no, I don't think this person is husband material, or that, you know, I would like to have a lifelong relationship or find myself down to him or something of that sort. So she says, sorry, I don't mind being your friend, but I don't think I'd like to have you as a partner. Now he loves in inverted commas her so much that he gets so angry that he throws acid on her face. And the reason he gives is because I love her so much and I can't bear that she is going to have somebody else in her life. So you see, what has that love turned into? It has turned into hatred. Supposing just before he had made up his mind and he's going to throw this acid, this girl turns around and says, sorry, I think I made a mistake. I think you're such a wonderful person. I would like to marry you. What happens to all the hatred, including the acid? Finished in a moment. And this fellow again says, oh, I love her. So you see how these emotions keep oscillating. And the other very interesting thing is that we don't necessarily like a person whom we love. And there are a lot of people whom we like but we don't love. You have some very nice, quiet person, let's say a shopkeeper or a neighbor, somebody like that, who goes out of the way to be nice to you, who's always doing some favors, who's making some nice gestures. Individually also that person has so many good qualities which you admire. You can learn so much about life from that person. So you go on and on and on liking that person, you would say, oh, he's one of the most fantastic people, I'm so happy to have him in my life, and I look for opportunities. But if somebody asks, do you love him? No, I don't. I like him immensely, but I don't love him. The counterpart of that, a mother has a son who has become absolutely horrible. Rebellious, this, that, he has become a drug addict, he is committing crimes, he is getting beaten up by the police and this and that. The mother finds out that police have locked him up, she makes nice homemade food and goes and gives it to him in jail. She loves him so much. But does she like him? No, obviously not. A mother who holds very good values, principles and all that, how can she like a young man who is so frivolous, who is stealing things, who is a drug addict and who is cheating people and this and that? She cannot like anything of that sort. These are some of the intricacies of this concept of love that we need to be clear on. Because what we are going to focus on, as I put it today, is this thing called the loving relationship. Okay. Now, what happens when person? This is another interesting thing. When we talk about romantic love, let's say a boy and girl are getting very, very friendly with each other. They're getting closer and closer and they've been having a very wonderful time. One fine day, one of them tells the other person, I love you. What is the other person supposed to say? Immediately?
I love you too.
I love you too. Now, 5 minutes before, that person didn't feel like saying I love you too. And the person is not saying that just because you have said it now, why should I immediately say, my tube light is blowing, so I love you. Supposing the other person says, hey, I like you very much, you're a good friend, and of late I've been having a nice time. But now that you have said that you love me, give me some time to think over whether I also really love you and whether we can move into a loving relationship. That person's ego will be hurt so badly, he'll say, get lost, I don't want you. I want instant you know, 2 minute noodles. I want you to immediately say, yes, I love you, too. This is the funny part of the whole thing. How, as I told you, how the loving not converted into a relationship, how it is misused, misunderstood, and this and that. Okay, one spark came in his mind. Till yesterday, he was thinking of her as a very nice girl, very good friend, very reliable person, all that was going on. Suddenly, one fine day, you know, Gyan comes to him, an enlightenment under the Bodhi tree that he loves her. And he can go, he can tell her that, you know, I've been seriously thinking about our relationship, I've been thinking deeply about you. And I think that, you know, I don't consider you only as a friend. I think that I love you so immensely, I'd like to have a permanent relationship with you or something like that. Can you please give it a thought and would you like to, you know, think over this and reciprocate and think? Nobody does that. All this is because of these myths that are created around this one word called love. I was mentioning an example of a couple where the girl, within no time after marriage, says, I don't like this guy, I don't want to spend the rest of my life with him. And obviously, when everybody asked her, what is wrong with him? Did he beat you up? Is he a womanizer? Is he a drunkard? Is he this? Is he that? Nothing. I just don't like her. I can't visualize spending the rest of my life with him. When I spoke to the boy broke down and started crying and literally said, I will touch your feet, I will be eternally grateful to you. Please get my wife back to me. Do something or the other to make sure that she doesn't leave me and go away. I love her so much. It's okay, I'm not going to do anything. I'll differently convey your sentiment that this is how deeply you feel. So when I'm sitting and talking to the girl, I said, you know what happened? Your husband said this, that he loves you so much. He can't live without you and this and that. She said, what does he know about me? If I give him a questionnaire, a multiple choice questionnaire with 50 questions, probably 45 out of 50 he will give the wrong answer. He doesn't know me as a person. We've hardly interacted, we've hardly built a relationship, and it was an arranged marriage. We hardly know each other. So when he says that he loves, let's say her name was Sita. So when he says that I love my wife, he is loving that label called my wife. Okay. He does not love Sita. He doesn't even know Sita. How can he love her? So please don't get carried away by, you know, all this emotion and sentiment and all that. I love my wife so much. I want her back and all that. If in the place of Sita, anybody else was there, he would have said, I love her. Because to him, wife is a possession. My wife, my property, my thing to hold on to. And how can this person say that I don't want to live with you? So it is more of an ego, more of whatever else you want to call it. But do you think anybody will agree with the girl? What a tough time she had. I had to really work with her parents and so many other people. This fellow, of course, went off in a huff and got very angry when nothing happened. But even her own parents, it took me months to keep interacting with them, slowly explaining to them what is going on. A girl whom they had given birth to and lived with for 25-30 years, they could not understand her sentiment, they could not understand what is her definition of love and why she says that I cannot love this person. The same parents who would say that we love our daughter so much, we are willing to give our life for her. I don't mind sacrificing my life for the sake of my daughter, I love her so much. But when she says, I don't want this, they are not willing to accept that. Okay, so what is this concept of a loving relationship? That is one. The other thing that I come across very, very strong. Okay. So, here is this person. I'm using man-woman love only as an example, but it applies to any other form of love as far as I'm concerned. It's just the manifestation which differs here and there. But let's take a typical this man and woman who have got married to each other. Now, the wife genuinely wants to love the husband, wants to. She is not looking at his attributes, his traits, his qualities. She says that I have committed myself lifelong to this human being. He is my life partner, therefore I have to love him. So I will go out of the way to express and to build up this relationship and to make it very loving and caring so that we live the rest of our life happily. But for whatever reason, she does not get reciprocation. The man is not, I mean, he's doing his basic duty and this and that, whatever it is, he's providing things of that sort. But there is no expression of love from that side. Now, does the woman say, see, it is a two-way relationship. It is supposed to be mutual and voluntary. Nobody can force somebody to love somebody else. So after having made all the efforts, if I realize that this person just does not love me, now I need to look inward and decide where I want to go, what I want to do with my life. Do I want to continue, you know, as two strangers living under one roof just for the sake of continuing with life and things? Do I want to separate and divorce or whatever? Just look inward. But you know what most people do? She will go on making efforts to change him. And she has this wonderful thought that if I go on showering my love on him, one day he will realize how good I am. And he will wake up one fine day and say, oh my, you've been so loving for years and years, you've been taking care of me. Now I've fallen madly in love with you and the rest of my life. But you know what happens in real life? This was a joke about a person who has been married for 20, 30 years and he has fallen sick, he has a heart attack, whatever it is, and he is in hospital. His very committed and dedicated wife has left everything in 24/7. She's there with the husband in the hospital. She's taking care of every possible need. This pillow is not okay, you want some water, you want me, shall I increase the fan, whatever. Minute to minute, whatever he needs, she is providing for him. And he gets into a very pensive mood and he says that, yeah, last 1 week I have been on bed in this hospital and you know, you have been here with me when I got this heart attack. She says, of course I'm there, but I will be. No, I'm just recollecting 30 years of our marriage. You know, just after our marriage, I had that scooter accident, I've fallen down and all that, and you were with me. Then after some time, you know, my mother fell sick and you know, we had to do a lot for her, take care and all that. I mean, we were pretty much, yes, of course. Then after that, this happened, I lost my job and we went through a very bad financial situation. Then you were there with me. Yes, of course. So that's what I've been thinking. You caused me so much bad luck. We can laugh over it. But believe me, sometimes that is what happens. I'll give you a real life incident. There was this lady who was married for whatever 20 years or something of that sort and had suffered very badly in that relationship. And finally, she got fed up and she said, no, I don't want to live with this person. I want a divorce. She went to her best friend and said, can you connect me to some lawyer or somebody like that? And I want to separate her. That friend was very concerned for her and she said, okay, one last child before you go for a legal procedure. I know Ali, who's a counselor and this. So I don't need to go for counseling. Okay, fine. She came to me. And she narrated from A to Z how much she had suffered in this last 20 years. That husband was absolutely horrible to her. Then I asked her that, you know, since it's a two-way relationship, I can't do anything individually. So do I have your permission to contact your husband and talk to him? I don't think he will respond, but if you want, you go ahead. Do I have your permission to tell him everything that you have told me? Is there anything that I should not do? It's all very open, nothing that you can tell. Okay. I called up this gentleman. And I said, the wife has come to me for counseling. So I thought I should get here. Sure, sure, sure. Immediately he agreed. When do you want me to come down? He came down. I said, see, I laid the cards on the table. Frankly, this is what she has said. I'm not saying she's right or wrong, but I'm just putting the points before you, what she has told me. She said that you are very rude to her. Yeah, I am. She said that you use, you know, unparliamentary language and foul words and all that when talking to her, when she's just you know, not used to that. Yes, I do that. She said that, you know, even when you have money, if she wants something personal for her own self, you're very stingy and you don't give her money. Yes, I do that. Most of the time, you know, a simple thing like wedding anniversary or birthday or something, you just totally ignore and you don't bother to have anything. Yeah, I do that. Whatever I was telling, happily nodding his head and saying, yes, I do that. I said, then why do you expect your wife to be, you know, nice to you? And obviously that is the reason why, you know, she felt that I should separate out or divorce or whatever it is. He said, just 1 minute. Did she tell you how long we have been married? I said, yeah, she told me that you've been married for 20 years. Did she tell you, since how long I have been having these habits? So for a moment I thought maybe earlier he was good and something went wrong and that's why he is doing this. I said, no, from what I recollect. She said, from day one you have been like that only. Not that from the day after the wedding you have been having all these habits and attitude. That's the point. He said, from the day I got married, I have been the same till now. Okay. One day after marriage, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year after marriage, she didn't say, I can't tolerate this, I'm getting out, I want divorce separation. 20 years we have lived in harmony with me shouting at her and she crying. And nothing has happened. Why suddenly out of the blue she says she wants a divorce? Has something gone wrong with her? Do you think I should take her to a psychiatrist? So forget about what the man is doing, his attitude and all that. Can you empathize with the person and understand that he had got so used to the fact that this is what a husband-wife relationship is all about? I shout and scream at her and 5 minutes later she says, hot chapati is ready, come and have your dinner. So obviously she's giving me a license. And not once, not 10 times, not 100 times, not for 20 years. And now suddenly after 20 years, what's gone wrong with her? This is what happens when a person loves too much. You can still love the person for whatever the reason. As I told you, one can even love a film star. You can adore a film star. And you know, sometimes people have that. They put up posters all over the place. They do the, even their TV will show their film star or whatever it may be. That's it. But as long as you are not converting that into a loving relationship, you land up over there and tell your favorite hero or heroine that, see, for the last so many years I've been madly in love with you. Before you know it, his wife and children will come and meet you. He may be a happily married man or whatever it is. So we know that to build a loving relationship, it has to be two-way and it has to be nurtured from time to time. But people who love too much make the elementary mistake that as long as I love that person will reciprocate the love back to me. Which not only does not happen, but it creates a very awkward situation, which I keep telling you about my favorite author, Scott Peck. In the book called The Road Less Traveled, he has one entire chapter on dependency. He says, dependency masquerades as love. When I'm dependent on someone, I say I love that person. I don't say I'm dependent on that person. Now, physical dependency, monetary dependency and all that is fine. A child is obviously physically dependent on the parent. The child is too small to take care of himself. Sometime towards the end of the life, the role reverses. The parent has become very old and bedridden and sick or something of that sort. The child looks after the parent the way you would look after a small baby or a small child, so the road reverses. Now those type of dependency, same thing with financial. There may be a husband and wife where the wife takes care of the home and family and children and everything. Whereas the husband goes out to work and gets the money. So the wife is dependent on money, finances of the husband. The husband is dependent on the wife for taking care of the house and giving a good upbringing, creating a loving environment in the family, all that. So her role is as important. They are complementing each other. This is what we refer to as codependency. So you find your niche areas and you say, okay, when I'm earning so much, why do you also want to go to an office and earn something more? Why don't you be here? And she says, okay, I'm fine with this, whatever else. In so many areas, even between a child and a parent, you may say that you take care of this, I will take care of this need of yours, or whatever it is. I'll come and pick you up from the school and take you home, because walking down the buses are not okay. But since I'm spending so much time picking you up and all that, when they come back home, you wash the dishes for me, because we don't have domestic help. Again, it is a co-dependency. But when it becomes a one-way dependency, if a person becomes emotionally dependent on the other person, and the reason we give is love. I love this person so much that I cannot live without him or her. That is something that I find very amazing. I used to think that the only thing that you cannot live without is oxygen, right? If you don't get oxygen for a few minutes, you die. Now, when you say that I cannot live even one day or whatever it is without this person, you are making that person your oxygen cylinder. And nobody wants to be an oxygen cylinder to somebody else. It's a huge responsibility. That if I don't take care of the basic need of this person, this person says I cannot live. How many people threaten that? If you leave me and go, I will commit suicide. Why should you commit suicide? She is leaving you and going away. You move on, do whatever you want with your life. No? How can you say that I cannot live without you? Now that is a fundamental fallacy of a loving relationship. A loving relationship should enhance your quality of life. It should not be an SOS or an oxygen cylinder. Because if you treat that person as your, you know, means to survive and means to live, that means on a minute-to-minute basis you need help. Supposing my breath goes so bad that I have to be on oxygen. Even if 10 days I am on oxygen, if they take away that oxygen for 10 minutes, I will still die. No? The oxygen cylinder provided life to me for 10 days. But if it is deprived for 10 minutes, I am dead. So all that 10 days of that oxygen serve no purpose if I cannot get it for 10 minutes. Now human beings in relationships do not want that. So the more I become clingy, the more I start going closer and closer, saying that I can't live without you and this and that, the more she starts backing off. And then I wonder, why is this? When I am loving this person so much, when I care so much for this person, and I want to spend all my time and everything with this person, why is this person backing off? Not because he or she does not love you, but because you are suffocating the person. In this dependency thing, Scott Peck says, you know, in Western countries, they go around with a t-shirt message. They write something which they want to tell the whole world and all that. So, it is like a person going around with a t-shirt message saying, I need your love. The moment you see somebody coming and conveying that I need your love, he says, it is like an emotional beggar. You step out of here and you see a beggar coming with a bowl. I need your money, I'm starving. Can you form a relationship with such a person? However poor he is, however destitute he is, you can only have pity on him. You will give him money. You may even say, come every day and shout at the gate, I will give you some food, take it and go. You can go to that extent also, you will feed him every day. But will you say, no, tomorrow is my birthday, why don't you come in and join us for our birthday celebration and take part with all the activities. You never think of doing that. Because what he has conveyed to you is that I am a beggar. I need your charity. But if a person comes to you and says that I have something to offer you, in return can I get your love? So if you go with a t-shirt message which reads, I deserve your love. Then the person takes up and says, what's so great about this person? Acha. Continuing on this factor of dependency, why do some people become dependent? Many others also start loving somebody and then they say that no. I was giving an example of a child. A mother who tries to give the best of upbringing to her child. But it, for whatever reason, he turns out to be a vagabond. He has become an antisocial. She can withdraw and say, I've done my duty, he's now an adult. He can lead his own life. If he comes to me asking for help, I'm still going to be available because I'm his mother. But if he gets locked up in jail, I'm not going to cook tiffin and take it. Let him learn lesson. Let him eat that jail food and learn certain lessons of life. That's the way to. And I don't think I can continue to love him this way because of his behavior and because of the way he is going about with his life. In case he changes, I'm still willing to love him. But if he does not, I cannot love. There's another mother which, as I told you, continues to pamper that child so much, making matters worse for him. That's another thing that happens if one person loves another too much. The more the mother keeps tolerating, initially it may have been small things as a little fellow, you know, he takes 10 rupees from his mother's purse and goes and buys chocolate or something. And father gets very angry and says, you are stealing, and mother says, no, 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 he's a small fellow, he doesn't know what is the meaning of money. So she starts pampering him. Any comments or questions on what I said so far?
What is your view on marriages are made in here?
Marriages are made in heaven, then they should have kept them there. Why did the gods send those marriages down here?
You were talking about emotional dependence.
Yeah.
So can we have emotional independence and yet be in a relationship?
Yes, very much.
How do we achieve that? How do we do that?
The first thing is to give space. You heard about that proverb which says that happiness is like a butterfly. You chase it and it runs away. It's very difficult to catch a butterfly. You grow flowers and it comes and sits on your shoulder. Right? The same thing. I love a person. I'm complete within myself. I'm not dependent on this person. I'm not going to die if this person leaves me and goes away or starts hating me or something. But my quality of life will improve. Because I love this person. I have a lot of regard for this person, I respect this person, I feel that this person can enrich my life. That is how you. If you have a friend who comes and says, oh, finally the lockout is being lifted, so next year in summer we have decided to go for a vacation, my wife and me. She loves the beaches, so she is going to Goa. I love hill stations, so I am going to Ooty. What would you think of such a couple? That's what they will start lecturing. Because they will say, what is this? You can't even take a vacation together. What sort of a couple are you? What they are forgetting is, there are 52 weeks in a year. 51 weeks they live under the same roof. For 1 week if they decide, I love the beaches, I have some friends who love the beaches. So let me go to Goa and I will have a nice time. You like hill stations in the summer and all that. You find some friends, go to the hill stations, spend a week and come back. This is how the beginning of the thing happens. But we are so programmed into it. I would say, if I come across such a couple, I would say, hats off to you, congratulations. You are strengthening here. So many things like that, you know. We push ourselves, we force ourselves to, you know, come together. Whereas, once you develop a good, loving relationship with somebody, and if it's a long-term relationship, like a family member, a child, a spouse, or whatever it is, I would say give as much space as possible. If you do that, you are actually strengthening your love. And there are 100 ways of doing it. In vacation, I just gave you some examples. There are so many ways in which you can do it. If you understand this concept of long-term relationship. And as I said, I gave you the example of the plant which I keep pouring water. I not only pour water on that plant, I don't take that plant out on the terrace or balcony or in the compound. I love this plant so much, I don't know what will happen with the sun's heat. So I'm going to keep the plant nice, lead within the four walls. Now it is an outdoor plant. It does not thrive. Whatever I do, fertilizer, this, that, water, everything, the plant withers away because the plant thrives on sunlight. That is one of the most important factors to remember in a loving relationship. Give the other person what the other person needs, not what you think the other person needs. And I'll even extend that to say, give the other person not only what he needs, but what he wants. First example of that would be, I have this friend who literally is in love with me. He, you know, is so attached to me, cares for me so much and this and that. Okay. He keeps coming very often. I hardly ever go to his place. One day I had to give him something important, some paper, something, I don't remember. I had gone out. I had a very tiring whole morning. I was out on some workshop, this, that, and I finished it. It was just about 1 o'clock. I was heading back here to have lunch. I was feeling very hungry. I said, let me stop for 5 minutes and give these papers to him and go. I stop and he says, Ali, you come after so many days. How can I let you go? Have a cup of tea and this. I said, this is lunchtime. I don't want tea at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And I'm in a hurry. I'm hungry. I want to go home. I didn't say it in so many words. I said, no, thank you. Hey, I know you enjoy tea. Whenever I come, you give me tea. So now that you have come, I want to give you tea. And this man kept on insisting. I had no choice but to drink that tea, spoil my appetite, and make up my mind that next time I'm not going to his office. So what happens is that he loves tea. Whenever he comes to my office, which is quite often, I offer him tea and he says, sure, I'd like to have it, I give it to him. So he presumes that when I come to his office, I would also like to have tea. That is where the need comes. The want, let's say 8 o'clock, 8:30 is the dinner time and the whole family gets together for dinner. Normally the husband comes home at 6 o'clock or something of that sort, has a cup of coffee, relaxes for some time and does something. 8 o'clock, children finish homework and this and that, and they all sit down like a good family and have dinner together. One day the husband has a very harrowing day in the office. Very stressful day. And it extends. Finally he reaches home, it is nearing 8 o'clock. He is so shaken up, so disturbed that he walks up to his wife and says, give me a nice hot cup of coffee. He says, see the time. It is already dinner time. You'll spoil your appetite. Just wait for 5 minutes, I'll give you dinner. I don't want dinner, I want a cup of coffee. How can you want coffee at 8 o'clock in the night? It is dinner time. And it will spoil your stomach, then you won't be able to eat anything properly. No, Baba, I had a very stressful, all the more reason you had a stressful day, no? You need good nutrition. I'll make some nice chapatis. Come on, you eat. Now she is right that a need is for nutritious food. The coffee will spoil his appetite. But there is a human being beyond the body, no, which is controlled by the mind. And his mind is saying, I just want to de-stress by having, I'm sort of, you know, I love that cup of coffee when I come home. Normally it would used to be at 6:30, whatever it is. Today it is 8 o'clock, 8:30, whatever. I still don't mind. I want to have. I am intelligent enough, capable enough to know that my need is food. You don't have to tell me. But my want today is coffee right now. I don't mind, I'll have dinner at 10 o'clock today. Or I'll spoil my appetite and barely eat dinner one day. It doesn't really matter. That is how loving relationships are made. If you understand, number one, that you don't give to the other person what you think he needs, but give to the other person what he actually needs. Secondly, when there is a conflict between need and wants, in a relationship, it is the want that goes on. I come across people who come and say that, you know, my father is 19 years old and he is severely diabetic. And he goes on insisting that he wants sugar in his tea. And I don't put sugar in his tea because he's severely diabetic. Doctors have said he should not have sugar. And you know sometimes what he does? He goes and steals sugar from the kitchen and puts it, and I get so angry. This is your love, right? You are the father's son or daughter, whatever, daughter-in-law, whatever you are, and you love him so much that when the doctor says, don't give him sugar, you make his life miserable by not giving him that one spoon of sugar for his tea. But his want at that time is to enjoy a nice cup of tea with sugar. What is going to happen? If he was destined to live up to 96, he'll probably die at 94. But he will have 4 years of happy life rather than 6 years of unhappy life. That is what we need to, you know, understand in so many different types of situations. Which brings me to another interesting point. You know, there are some very intelligent, capable, and very crafty people who know how to make the other person go on loving you immensely. They manipulate. Anything and everything becomes, if you love me, you would do this for me. Don't you love me? Won't you do this much for me? Now, how is that connected to each other? God only knows. No logic stands to reason. But they start manipulating, saying that, you know, if you love me, you will not be talking so much to your mother. I love my mother. I have a separate loving relationship with my mother and separate loving relationship with my spouse. Okay, if I'm neglecting my spouse and spending time with the mother, it's okay. But even when I'm not in any way neglecting, I'm doing it when my spouse is not around, the spouse can manipulate and say, how much you talk to your mother and you don't talk to me that much. That means you don't love them. I'm just giving a very simple example, but people use it very often to manipulate. When they realize that this person loves me so much, and this person is not going to be assertive and stand up to his or her rights and say that, you know, this and that has got nothing to do with each other, you tell me what your needs are. Right now, what do you want? You want me to sit and chat with you? I'll do that. You want me to make a cup of coffee? I'll do that. Whatever you want, you tell me, I'll do that. But don't point out to my relationship with my mother, which is a separate thing. How are we mixing up these two? When you do not have that ability to assert yourself, you can land up in a relationship with somebody who can go on manipulating you for the rest of your life. It even happens, for example, in offices. Bosses take advantage of the person who is the meekest person, who doesn't know how to say no. That one is loaded with the maximum work and shouted at also. Whereas the others get away happily from that. So these type of habits, they can overflow into anything. It starts with one person whom you love so much that you don't want to say no to him. And you allow that person to keep manipulating you. When it becomes a habit within you, it starts expanding to others. How many times I have seen a very docile, very submissive, and a very polite and quiet wife who keeps on listening to the badgering by her husband. Okay, he's my husband, he works hard, he gets stressed out, that's his temperament. He shouts at me, but that doesn't mean he doesn't love me, he also loves me. Once his temper comes down, then he is nice to me. She goes on justifying it and allowing him to get away with that type of one-sided relationship. One fine day she realizes that her son, who has now come to adolescence, is talking the same language as his father. And she gets a shock of her life. She says, I expected my son, at least, who has seen that I am suffering so much, I would have expected him to side by me. And he is talking in the same nasty manner as his father does. His father is my husband, so I keep quiet. Why should I listen to my own son? But by the time it's too late. But change him when he starts getting nasty. Now tell me, why does that happen? A son who is seeing that his mother has always been loving, caring, nice, polite, and has been seeing that the father has always been nasty, growling, this, that. He loves his mother immensely. So he should at least say that, okay, if daddy is nasty to mama, at least let me be nice to mama. Let me do some little small gestures, let me be polite to her or something. No, he goes the other way. Yes.
Yeah, I think it happens because the mother has been constantly listening to the father.
Yeah.
So he's thinking that that's how love is.
Like, that is how love is. That is how a relationship is. Women are meant to be shouted at. Macho men shout at women and they get away. So he doesn't know that there is any other option. He thinks that's the only way. So now that I'm growing up and I'm becoming a man, I will start with my own mother and then he'll take it out on his wife also. The same cycle will repeat itself. This is something that goes on generation after generation. Saas bhi kabhi bahu thi. It just goes on indefinitely like that. In fact, many a time, people who love too much, like let's say this lady loves her husband, son, everybody. She loves so much that she's willing to sacrifice anything and everything. Okay? So she says, okay, even if my husband physically hits me, I won't protest. Now, initially what happens is that this little fellow is seeing father hitting the mother. He gets very scared. To him, it's not right, wrong. This person is correct, this person is good, this person is bad. No. To him, it is amma, appa. My world revolves around them. They are my identity after all. And something like this is happening. So he starts getting very scared. He starts withdrawing and things like that. He feels very helpless. Appa is one huge terror. And when he can hit, amma, if I come in, what will happen to me? He bides his time. He keeps growing up. One fine day, he comes to adolescence and he is one hulk of a fellow. And the next time the father is hitting the mother, he comes and stands in between and says, hey, don't hit my mother. Forget about what the father does. What does a typical mother do? Don't talk his 2 mile. How dare you talk to your father like that? Don't you respect your father? This is not the way to talk to your father. Get out from here. Who asked you to come and interfere? My own mother, whom I love immensely, whom I want to protect, whom I have seen suffering. One fine day I try to help her out and I get shouted in the nastiest of terms. So reinforce that what daddy is doing is right. Even mother has said no. Now I have the license to do it. Okay, then one very interesting thing, this concept of unconditional love. Oh, what? I keep literally laughing at it when people say, the only person with whom you can have unconditional love is the one sitting right on top. Not in Gurukul, pure love. Because that's the beauty of it. With anyone else, if I am nice to somebody and that person is not nice to me, I immediately say, what is wrong? Why can't this person be nice to you? But I am very nice to God Almighty. I say my prayers, I read the scriptures, I go to the temple, I bake coconuts, I give charity. I do every possible thing to please God. And then I request God. God, I've studied so hard. If I don't get 90%, I will not get admission in MBBS. That's my dream and my life. Please make sure that I get 90%. The result comes and I get 75%. What happens? People will come to me and say, you see, God has his own wisdom. We cannot understand the meaning. Maybe God wants you to do something more meaningful than being a doctor. So you have to respect whatever God. He is antaryami. He knows everything. So you could, okay, thank you God. At least you gave me 75%. I'm not talking about that. Other than that, no other relationship can be unconditional. And when you love somebody so much that you want to make it unconditional, saying that whatever the person does, I'm still going to love this person, you're not doing him a favor. As I told you, number one, he will start taking advantage of you and the relationship. And once he gets used to that, he will do it everywhere else. If a wife is so docile, so meek, so submissive, that whatever he does, she's going on with a loving relationship with him. He goes to the office where, let's say, he holds some position of authority, he's a manager, director, whatever it is. He starts treating his subordinates the same way because he believes that I have the right to be the macho fellow and to do whatever I want. And who has contributed to that? It's the wife who has contributed to that. If the wife had turned around one day and said that, hey, we are equal partners, okay? We are supposed to be life partners, but I'm getting my doubt right now with the way you are behaving with me. So I need to remind you that this is not done. I love you and I intend to continue loving you till the rest of my life. But this is not acceptable to me. This is going to create a lot of rift and barriers and cracks in our relationship. So you better really think over that. And then start implementing it in whatever little way. I'm not saying you break apart the marriage or something of that sort. Every weekend they used to enjoy, this fellow used to spend the whole Sunday and wife used to be cooking and doing everything. This Sunday I'm going out with my friends. You've not been very nice to me the whole week, so I thought at least let me get some relief by being with some nice people who at least smile at me, so I'll recharge my batteries by doing that. Monday I'll come back and again face your grouchy face. So I'm going. She has to implement. That is where people fail. I know people who go on threatening, whether it is to a child, I will throw you out. I didn't do this. If you're watching so much TV, I'll throw the TV out of the window. What Amma will throw out the TV? We know that it was. She is still paying EMIs on that TV. Where will she throw it out? It's not a fool. Anything of that sort, you know, wherever the person in the field, you have to implement it. So when you say that you're using too much TV time, and I love you very much, but I cannot allow you to do that, tomorrow I'm going to switch off the TV for 1 hour. That's how we are going to do. Anything of that sort has to be brought. Let me share one more thing before I come to the last part. People who love too much get into such a bad habit that they start replaying the same recording even after the problem is over. One example was of a lady who at a very young age, I think she was 16, 17, fell in love with a fellow who was an alcoholic, 10 years older than her. She decided to become a rescuer. I will marry him and set him right, and this is a great difficulty with all resistance from her parents and this and that. She literally ran away with this fellow, got married. He became a wife beater. He continued to drink. He never gave up with that. She tried her level best. Finally, she walked out of that marriage. 1 year later, 2 years later, whatever it is, she decided, okay, I'm still young, fit, fine, and I need to do this thing. So she starts looking around. And she again marries an alcoholic. And again, the same story repeats itself. And then with great difficulty, she breaks off that second marriage and comes back. After some time, she gets into a relationship with a guy who is an alcoholic. And he's not even married to her, but he keeps beating her up. When she gets rid of that person, she gets into a relationship with a fourth alcoholic in her life. That is when her best friend brought her to me for counseling. She had got so programmed that I am a rescuer. Achha, by the way, this girl's father was an alcoholic person. So she had seen the bad effects of alcohol even as a child. But she said, I can't do anything to change my father, I'm a child. So at 18 years of age, she said, if I get married to this guy, at least I will bring about a change in him. And therefore I will fulfill it. I failed, I will go for a second marriage. I failed in the second marriage, I'll go for a relationship. I failed in that, I'll go for another relationship. They never learn that lesson. So that is one thing that I want you to understand, is how a person becomes an addict. Sometimes, you know, a person becomes addicted to drugs or alcohol or cigarettes or whatever, and he just cannot get over that thing. He keeps slipping back all the time. This is what happens. This also becomes an addiction if you love too much. Okay, since we should always end up on a happy note, no? Let me tell you something. In a real life case, not back this happened. There was this 75, 76 year old lady who came to me and said that I was married very young. I mean, married in those good old days and all that. Very nice husband and things like that. And we got together. We have three children. All three children have grown up, married, very happy, settled, doing well in their careers. I've got very loving, caring grandchildren and this and that. And my husband is 5 years older than me. He's 81, I'm 76, whatever it is. He has also led a very respectable life and he's retired. Financially, we are very well off. We have our own and we are living in the same locality, same place for the last 50 years. So we know everybody around. We have a beautiful relationship with our neighbor. We did that. We belong to that association, club, things like that. Our children, grandchildren very regularly visit. We have kept our independence. We are living alone. We have very good domestic help. We have a live-in servant who has been with us for 25 years. She continues to stay with us and take care of all our needs. Plus, we have other domestic help, we have a driver, we have these, that. Everything is going fine. So, I would have thought that, okay, now, you know, sunset years and we are going to march into the sunset together. My husband suddenly started getting cranky. And he started pointing out to smallest of things. Why is that kept at this angle? Why can't you keep it like this? Why is this fan going at 1? Why can't it be run at 2? Why did you keep that chair here and why not there? Morning to evening is pointing out something or the other. Such minute things. He's retired, he's become old, he doesn't step out much, so he's there at home. He's taking it out on me. Even that I said, okay, he's becoming a cranky old man. Okay, let me tolerate. Then he went on to the next phase of saying, if you don't behave properly, I will throw you out. This is happening. Don't be silly. No. Every second day he started saying, I will throw you out. I will divorce you. Finally, she came for counseling. I listened, we went through the whole thing. All that happened, catharsis, this, that, after 3-4 sessions. One day I just made her sit down and I said, that, do you love your husband? Yes, of course, I do very much. Sincerely, even with his nasty habit. Yeah, as long as he doesn't overstep and make things so bad, a little bit I can still tolerate and I can okay. Yet, can you live without your husband? She said, actually, yes, because you know he's 80 plus and he's not giving very good health and this and that. So mentally somewhere I know that. You know, there's a possibility he will go away before me and I will have to live the rest of my life alone. So something about the life. And as I said, I've got loving children, grandchildren, neighbors, society, my hobbies, my spiritual pursuits. I've got so many things to keep me going that even if, so mentally I prepared myself that if and when that happens and if he goes away, my life will continue for whatever the number of years. I said, would you like to try something? It's not that I'm telling you to do, just give it a thought. Next time the person says that, if you don't behave yourself, I will throw you out. Tell him that I'm fine with it. She did that. She said, I've been thinking. So many times you've told me that you can't tolerate me, you have so many complaints about me. I don't want you to suffer. I don't want you to have unpleasant days continuously. So if I'm making life so miserable for you, I think what you're saying is right. Only difference is that this flat belongs to me, so you're not going to throw me out. I'm going to throw you out. If you only have enough money, you can go and, you know, buy yourself a property wherever you want. I love you. Ideally speaking, I'd like to spend the rest of my life with you. But in case you feel so strongly that you cannot live with me, I don't want to torture you with this. So let me know when and how you will be moving out. This man stared and stared and stared at his wife. Slowly he slipped down from the sofa, went on the carpet and held her legs and broke down and started crying. Please don't ever leave me and go away. And they lived happily ever after. That is what love is all. Any last questions, doubts, comments?
How do you see, for example, married couple and they have a first baby, and now towards the child,
yes,
happens. And the second baby then goes to the baby.
Yes. Why should there be a ration that this much to my spouse, this much to my first child, this much to my second child? The more you love, if your love is really of the true kind, then the more you love, the more it should expand. You should be able to take in more and more people into your love. But people who talk about exclusivity in love, no? That why are you spending time with the baby and why not with me? Or why are you spending time with my younger sibling and not with me? That is where they are going wrong, and it has to be nipped in the bud. When you find that somebody is talking about rationing love and compartmentalizing, that person has not understood the concept of a loving relationship. As I said, a loving relationship can exist even from a distance. Forget about taking care of your loved one on a day-to-day basis. Your loved one may be somewhere else in a different location, and the loving relationship can continue even if that person meets you once in a year or whatever it is. It should not affect the other relationships. That is what it is.
So how, I mean, I'm just asking out of curiosity, like why do, I mean, long distance relationships and all this stuff, why are there some people where, you know, like how you said,
yeah,
it still continues and they're still together,
yeah,
or but some people are just, they cannot bear the long distance, why does that
happen? When I take the session on marriage and the stages of marriage, you know that. The first stage of marriage, after your honeymoon phase is over and you know that thrill and excitement is over, you come back to what is known as the developmental phase of your marriage. So if in that developmental phase you have built a strong bond, and after that one of the spouses says that I want to go abroad and study, or I'll take up a job in another city, or whatever may be the reason, the bond is already there and lost. The same thing as it happens, let's say, with your child. If you have an excellent relationship with your child and one day the child has to go to hostel or to work in another city, your love for your child doesn't reduce because you have built that. That is what we want. Thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Okay, I'll log off. On 26th, we have anger management on FB Live. So you all can log in again. You can like our page and you can be updated with whatever is happening here at Banjara. So yes, that's it. And HH talks happen, like you all know, every third Thursdays. So I think very soon we'll do away with the live sessions. So next month onwards, we'd love to see you here, third Thursday of October. So thank you so much. I'm logging out now. Bye.